see five lifters in their singlets. Of the five, four of them are world champions, world record holder. One of them is not. Now, can you tell by looking at this which one is not? The sixth person that has the sweatshirt, sweatpants, is Kurentsov. He is a world and Olympic champion and all that, but he's not in the singlet there. And the reason I ask this is because if you look at the development of the person, you could tell whether he's using the right muscles or not in lifting. Okay, I'll tell you the difference here. If you look at the development of these lifters, notice that the traps are very prominent in these four. It goes, slopes down and it ends abruptly. That's a good sign. That means they are shrugging like that. Now, all of them have full lats, latissimus. So it's bulging out more or less in the back. Naturally, they have rounded buttocks. They all have. This is the only one that is kind of flat. It doesn't have the prominent traps, nor the lats full, or the buttocks rounded. The way you lift determines what kind of muscles you're gonna have. Now, these four are lifting properly. This is Rozhenkov, and this is Taltz, and Shari, and yeah, this is David Rieger. Yeah, notice his traps are really developed. If you use the right technique, you're gonna have that the area developed. If not, you won't have it. The traps are there because they shrug on the clean. Not on the snatch, on the clean. If you start shrugging on the snatch, you restrict the elbow movement. That's why you will never see me stress shrugging on the snatch. But I do stress shrugging on the clean. It's all in the shoulder movement. Because all it is bringing the bar up to your navel height and going right under it. Whereas the snatch, you gotta bring it up here. That's why the elbows come way up. One of the most important thing in lifting is having a good strong back arch. A lot of people take the back arch for granted. You're all sitting down here. Sit on the front edge of your seat. Okay? Now just relax. So usually when you relax, your hip turns in. Now instead, this time stand or sit tall. Notice how your hip kind of rotates? You sit tall. Okay. Now relax again. Yeah, now you're slouching, so your back is buckled. Sit tall and place your hand on your knees and take a real deep breath. Lift your chest as high as it could go without raising your shoulder. Don't breathe in like that, but rather try to breathe in and bring your chest way up. Try to bring your chest up to the point where it could touch your chin. Right, you notice how your lower back really tightens up? Now that's how it's supposed to be when you're supposed to start lifting. The lower back is really tight all the time. At no time in Olympic weightlifting should your back buckle or relax. It should always be tense like that. On your snatch, on your clean, on all your pulls, your back gotta be arched. It's not good enough that it's flat. It has to be arched. The more arched you are, the better it would be. Now, how many of you have done bench presses? Can I see a raise of hand? Okay. How many of you have gone heavy on bench presses? Okay. You notice when you do bench press, what do? You exaggerate the back arch, right? You take a deep breath and you exaggerate the back arch. You get more leverage that way. That's the same thing in Olympic lifting. You've got to arch your back strongly, as much as you can. That gives stability to your whole spine, which has all these vertebrae, you know. You want to lock the vertebrae so that it becomes one piece. Too many people I've seen on the platform yesterday, they bent over and they got everything pretty well set, and then all of a sudden, like that, and their head jars and all that, they're using their upper body, not their legs. You could see them jarring their head as they yank the bar off the floor. That's an incorrect way of lifting. That means they would never extend to the fullest height. They are cutting it like I'm five, I used to be 5'6", I'm 5'4" now. But my idea is, when you are lifting, if I'm 5'6", I should be stretching to 5'7" if I can. That's how you get leverage, standing as tall as you can be. Good lifting is smooth lifting. You pick the weight off the floor very smoothly and it accelerates. And you can't do it if you are not using your legs. But if you're standing until 5'4 or 5'3, that means you cut your legs off because you're sneaking under the bar already. Get the maximum pull by stretching as tall as you can. And you hasten going under by shrugging on a clean. At one time or another, your feet is going to be jumping from this pulling position to squatting position. If you don't jump, you're not taking advantage of the right leverage. Most times I have people start and they don't jump. I force them to bring their feet in a little closer, point their toes a little bit straighter. And when they pull, automatically the feet start spreading out and jumping out and going to a better position for squatting. Because squatting and pulling is two different types of stance. So you have to understand these positions. If you do it right, no problem. The fact that you are standing tall and you are jumping at the instant where you are standing the tallest and you shrug, you are shrugging your body straight down. You're not shrugging to lift the weight higher. You're using the bar to shrug your body down. So if you do it correctly, the person almost disappears right under the bar. And if they got a strong back arch, they'll hit the bottom before the bar does. And the bar would hit the chest, and if they're upright, they'll bounce right out. How many of you have really seen any lifter bounce out of this squat clean? They usually sit and then stand up. Well, that's like doing a front squat or a squat, going down and sit and then stand up, which is hard. It's easier to bounce out. And how can you bounce out? Making sure your back is arched and your body is perfectly upright. Because then you have two things going for you. One, the flexibility of the bar. When it strikes, it's like an anvil and a hammer. The harder you hit with the hammer on the anvil, the more the hammer bounces up. The same thing here. When your body is upright and you hit bottom of the squat, that bar is going to go down and quick right up. So you get that rhythm. Not only that, the muscle of your thigh is stretched tight, so it's going to contract better too. So you got two forces there, the rhythm of the bar and the stretching of the thigh muscle. And so you could do bounce right out of the clean. If you do it correctly, you'd be amazed that when you hit bottom and come up, you're almost halfway out of the squat clean before you realize, wow, that was easy. Now, you got all this energy saved for the jerk. You have to start analyzing what's the correct way of doing things. Now, there are certain rules on this lifting position, when you are upright and you let your arm hang, shoulder is right in the middle of your body, and you could go down and pick up a pair of dumbbells very easily. But a barbell is in front of you. So you can't squat in between the barbell. You have to be bending forward, and your shoulders got to be rotated forward. This is the position of a real lifter. Shoulders got to be forward, not back here. Okay? Now understand this too. Anytime the shoulder goes into the back, that bar is going out to the front. So this is why you see a lot of people swinging the bar. They swing the bar, the arms don't even bend. So if the arm doesn't even bend, that means you're using leverage, you're losing the leverage because it's getting away from the body. You're supposed to keep it as close as possible to the body. That's the whole idea behind Olympic lifting. Keep the bar in a zone right here where it's the column that you have in the drawing here. I wrote area of balance. It's really the pillar of strength. The bar has to be in that groove there. If it goes outside, you're losing the leverage. You know, it's like taking a case of beer out of the trunk compartment of your car. You don't pick it up way out there. You bring it to the very edge closest to you, and then you can lift it. It's easier that way. And that's the whole idea. Keep that bar close to the body as possible. Then you got good leverage. Once the weight gets away from you, that means to counter it, your shoulders got to go backward. So anytime your shoulders going backward, you got it wrong. Your shoulders always got to be like this. And you got to imagine there's a plane right through, going through here, and you never break that plane. If you shove your hip forward, that means you broke that plane. Because now, instead of stretching tall, you're shortening yourself too by giving your hips in. That's sort of covered in my first book too. All that. You could exaggerate the pull by really leaning back and shoving your hip forward, but that's incorrect because you are shortening yourself. You got to stretch tall and remain tall with the shoulders in front. Once the shoulders go back, that means the bar is going to swing out. Really, when you think about it, it's common sense. The spread of your lats should be there all the time. You know the physique man, one of the standard poses is to flex the lats. And how do they flex their lats? The elbows got to come out to the side, the shoulders are leaning a little forward. It's never pinched back. In Olympic lifting, you never pinch the shoulder blade together in the back. When you start the lift off the floor, the action of the lat is to pull the arm in. So basically what you're doing is trying to pull the bar close to the body as possible. It's not letting it hang or swing away from you. You want to keep it close. So anytime you pull, that bar should be almost skimming along the body, the length of your body. That way you know it's in the right position. You should stay with your shoulders over the bar as long as you can. And when you stand the tallest, your legs are almost completely straight and your shoulder becomes the pivoting point, not the hips. So your shoulder stays where it is, the hips come forward. Most people think you get your legs straight and then you go back, pivot around your hip. No, it's pivoting on your shoulder. So the hip comes in. And that's how you get your maximum height. Acceleration. You start slow and start picking up speed. I see so many people lose the weight and all they have to do is start a little slower in their pull. That's all. If they start a little slower in their pull, their finish will be stronger. But you know, most people think, this is heavy, I gotta really pull hard. And what happens is, it's like shooting off over here, but then by the time it comes up here, it's fizzled out in strength. It's supposed to be just the opposite. It's supposed to start slow and pick up speed. So you're moving the fastest way up here. And that's where you take advantage of your bar and the shoulders by shrugging and all that to pull your body under. Explosion, anytime there's some kind of movement, sometimes they bring it up to here and then all of a sudden you can see a different speed there. That means they've cut the leg short and they use their back immediately. So they will not stretch their maximum height. So if they did it good, it's smooth all the way up to the top. What you're doing is, you gotta imagine, you're pushing down on a platform and pushing. Don't think of pulling, because once you start thinking of pulling, you cut your legs off and you're using your back only, and you don't use your legs. But if you keep thinking in terms of extend your legs as long as you can, you get a complete leg action, and that's what you need. This is Chris Arango, who held the world record in the light in the heavyweight class. Prior to him was Alexeyev. He was the one with the big belly and all that. But even Alexeyev lifted correctly, because when he stood tall, you couldn't see his belly. He had stretched out, so his belly went in. You know, I used to think, this guy looked like he's 9 months pregnant and all that. You know, because he was really grounded in his stomach. But when it came to Olympic clean and jerk, wow, there was nobody who could beat him, because he had the right leverage and he did it correctly. And I studied his body, and I thought, no wonder. His hip area is real thick, you know? And I thought, that's where the power is, right there. And he knew how to use it. He stretched tall, and that's vital to getting the maximum lift in your body. Too many people are cutting their pull short. So if you're 5'10", make sure you stretch to 5'10". Should be 5'11", 5'12", you know, 6 feet almost, if you can. I know that in Colorado Springs, a lot of time, they stress power snatching, power clean, and you power snatch until it forces you to go under. But the pull for power snatch and power clean is completely different than the pull for squat clean and squat snatch. If you're doing a power snatch, you start with your back immediately. Same thing in a power clean. You don't employ the leg, you explode off the floor. You are not providing the right type of pulling for the actual snatch and clean and jerk. I never have stressed power snatch or power clean, because it's a completely different type of pull. On the snatch, all you gotta do is bring the bar that high. You're not gonna power snatch anything. You might use a very light weight to warm up and all that. But other than that, no. This is as high as a bar has to go. On the clean, where your navel is.
So you're saying you should not power snatch or power clean?
You don't need to, because the pull is completely different. Okay. I don't advocate power snatch and power clean, because it throws you into the idea of, this is heavy, I better pull hard. And that's incorrectly. You gotta start slow and smooth and finish strong. Power snatch, power clean, that's what it is. Power. You're using power for making a lift. And then they brought in the Romanian coach, Dragomir. And he brought in the European style of training, five times a week, two times a day and all that. That really destroyed weightlifting in the United States. Because you don't have time to do it. You know, when you reflect back, way back into the 1950s, 40s, and 60s, we used to have three lifts, press, snatch, clean, jerk. We had seven bodyweight classes. So you were able to break the press, the snatch, clean, jerk, and total. Four records in one bodyweight class. And there were seven bodyweight classes. So you were able to have 28 world records. Of the 28 world records, usually 13 to 15 was held by the United States. The remainder was held by the Russians. You know, it's interesting because at that time, we had what they call the Cold War. It might be far beyond the time that you were born, maybe, but the Cold War meant that there wasn't a real war, but there was a antagonistic feeling between the two different countries, the United States and the Soviet Union. And the Soviet Union wanted to show that they had the superior idea, and they stressed two things, science and sports. Science, they put their Sputnik up in the air. They beat us on science. Sport, they looked around to see what's the best sport to be good in. And they thought weightlifting because it showed they have the strongest men in the world. Well, they couldn't say that because the few lifters that we had in the United States, and they were scattered all over, were better than those that the Russians produced. And the Russians had over 100,000 good lifters. They really specialized on Olympic lifting. But in the United States, all we had was a handful of lifters. We had John Davis, who was in New York. Shemansky, who lived in Detroit. Stanzik, who lived in Florida. Dave Shepard, who was in New York or Los Angeles. I was living in Hawaii. So we were scattered all over. We did not have any coach or anything like that. We sort of coached ourselves, okay? We also had to make a living. Now, in the Soviet Union, they had what they had, they were either, a student at the university, and usually they were like permanent university students, or they were in the military, so they had excuse to train. They specialized in weightlifting. In the United States, we had to make a living. You know, nobody foot our bill. If it hadn't been for Bob Hoffman, who foot the bill for us to go overseas for the World Championship and all that, there was no support at all for weightlifting. So we all had to make a living. So that means we had to put in 40 hours a week work, plus be able to train, not on two lifts, but three lifts. Now how did we do it? All we did was do the lift itself. We did not break it down into hang snatch, high pulls, and all these other accessory movements that they introduced later on. We didn't have time to do all those things. So all we did was press, snatch, clean and jerk, that's it, and squat. We had just enough time to do those things. So what happened was we worked on the lift itself, complete lift. How can you get better than doing the complete lift? See, nowadays all they do is hang clean, hang snatch. At my time, I could hang snatch world's record. I could hang clean world's record. But if I had to do it from the floor, it becomes completely different because it's passing the knee area that's the hard part. And you're avoiding that. So anything above the knee and all that is very easy. And a lot of coaches nowadays teach how to snatch and clean jerk from above the knee. So the lifter themselves can do it automatically. They learn it and it's easy, but they have to do it from the floor, completely different. Actually, it's a waste of time to do it from the hang at all. And high pulls and all that too is not really necessary. You've got to do it from the floor. Because that's what the lifting is all about. Not from the hang. But everybody is now emphasizing all these different phases of lifting. And they break down the lift and they break it down into 5 days of training and all that. In our days, we had limited time. I'll tell you a good example. Pete George, he's from Akron, Ohio. He was studying to be a dentist. He didn't have time to train. If he had only time to train a little bit, all he did was clean and jerk. And he introduced squat snatch as a scientific way of lifting. Now everybody's doing it. And I remember too that he asked Hoffman, you know, Bob, the world's championship is going to be held in Munich, Germany. If I found some way of getting to Munich, Germany to lift the world's championship, can you give me the money that you would have spent on the plane fare so I could pay for my tuition and my books? So Hoffman says, yeah, but can you make it there? You know, he says, I'll make it. You know what he did? He was in the ROTC. He borrowed someone else's ROTC uniform, went to an Air Force base close by, hitched a ride to London, from London to Munich. He lifted, won a gold medal, and then he flew back the same way. Yeah. He was the only person that would go away and come back with more money than when he left. But that's how frugal he was. And he made ends meet. He became a dentist. But that's how hard it was for us to make money. And his brother, Jim George, the younger brother, was always in the shadow of Pete. Pete was considered the boy wonder. And I thought, oh, Jim is going to have a hard time coming into breaking into Olympic lifting. But you know, Jim got to the point where he broke the snatch record, world's record, clean and jerk world's record. Hmm. Yeah, it's got to be the positive attitude you got to have. If you don't have that, you can't make it. Jim knew that he was under Pete's shadow, but he knew that he could do it on his own. So I recommend the front squat. Because the back squat, you could, you know, it's like powerlifting. Your butt doesn't go low and all that. You could be leaning forward and then using your back rather than the legs. Well, you gotta be upright when you go into the clean and all that. The snatching is different now. Snatching is inclined. But in the clean, you gotta be upright. And to do that, you gotta be able to front squat. And when I say front squat, that means the leg gotta collapse completely and come out. Your buttocks gotta hit your heels like. Then you're doing it correctly. Your thigh is gonna be flexed completely and you gotta be able to bounce right out. That bar has to bow and swing out. And if you do it correctly, you have no problem coming out of the squat. The whole arm is relaxed like a rope. That means that the big body muscles are working. And that's what you want, not the arms. So it's like getting a wet towel. Remember how you use the wet towel, you would snap it? The hand would be the same way. And if you do it correctly, it would snap and the arms would lock out and make a perfect snatch. But the moment you start swinging the weight, the arms don't even bend. You could see it from the person, you know, on the side. The arms don't bend. That means the bar is away from you. The bar's out, shoulders back, and you're swinging. And once you get that momentum, rotationary momentum going, it's hard to stop. That's why they might have the power to get it overhead, but they lose it. This is why it's so important to keep that bar traveling in that one narrow column. Goes up and goes down. You know, most people, they use the hook grip and all that for the lifting all the time. Well, I didn't. Because if you employ the hook, it's like using straps and you could pull hard, okay? It's only when the weights get real heavy that I would employ the hook. But other than that, I would employ the regular grip because that meant you had to lift smoothly off the floor. If you yank, your hand would open up. When I started lifting, I had no concept of really how to lift good and all that. I just trained hard. And then when I went to the Olympics in 52 Olympics, actually I was a cook in the army, and they were supposed to send me to Korea. And because the North Koreans were shooting off all the cooks, American cooks, because they heard that the American army moved on a stomach, and if they didn't have warm food, you demoralize them. So they would sneak behind and shoot the cooks. So I was one of the cooks in the training company. So naturally, I was supposed to replace one of the cooks. So when I reported in, they said, no, we got different ideas for you. What do you mean? Said, well, maybe you're going to get a discharge or something. I thought, I can't be getting a discharge, you know? He says, oh, you're a candidate for the Olympic team. So I was yanked off the team, yanked off the group that was going to go overseas, and then was able to train for the Olympic trials. And I made the Olympic team, and then they sent me to Helsinki for the Olympics. And I thought, wow, you know, now I have a mission to accomplish, and that is represent the United States at the Olympics, not as a cook and all that. So, but I took first place, and then after that, I got a long cablegram from Washington, D.C. saying that I have to serve my overseas term in Europe. So I had 9 more months to go. So I went to Europe, and I stayed there, and I started giving exhibitions, you know, because they had a lot of, weekend competition among the different teams and all that in Germany. They had every village had a team and all that, so they used to have a league and all that, and they call it Bundesliga and all that, which is federal big kind of league and all that. But in my case, they invited me all the time because I was an Olympic champion and all that, and I lifted as a guest lifter. But I lifted almost every weekend. And that's when I found out how to train correctly. That I train, and I figured that you can't just train for one contest. You gotta be able to train constantly and be able to improve on your lifts. And so that's what I did. I found out the more competition I got into, the better I became, simply because I knew what to expect. And it's not like in training where you have friends and you could take unlimited amount of attempts and you could be overweight and all that. No, you're in a contest. So by going into contests, you learn more about yourself, how to improve, so the next time you could do better. And that's what I did. All these lifters, some of the older people, you know, they used to have it in beer halls and all that competition. They follow you. You know, they know what you did the week before. And they want to see what you're going to do this time. So, you know, you got to keep their attention. And so you really worked good. Yeah, and they appreciate good lifting. So every time I would be, actually I was out lifting what Pete George did in the middleweight class. I was a light heavyweight, I mean lightweight class, 148. But when I was in Europe, because the Army Chow and all that, I went up to 165. But in 165, Pete George was an Olympic champion. But I was able to total what he did almost every weekend.
You actually competed every week?
Just about every week.
Just about every week?
Every weekend, yeah. You know, when I used to train in Sacramento, this is after the World Championships and after the Olympics and all that, when I returned back to Sacramento, I didn't have a car or anything like that, so I couldn't go to the YMCA. It was too much of a trouble to go to the YMCA. So oftentimes I would train in the basement of my house. The basement was nothing more than the dirt floor. So I used to lay some wooden planks. I would water the ground because the dust would raise, you know, but that would warp the wood too. But I would stand on the wood and, you know, you make do with what you have. I found out that when I train at home, if I did 305 clean and jerk, that was pretty good. If my brother came down to see me train, I'd automatically jump up to 320 or so. Okay, if a weightlifter came down, I'd go even higher. So I started equating all these things. If I could do 305 in training, that's good. If I could do better than that in training, that's good. But at the same time, in a contest, I'd start with 350.
You had an Olympic set, the revolving plates?
Yeah, yeah. I bought a second hand. Actually, it was a third-hand Olympic set.